We're on. All right. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this February 17, 2011 school board meeting. To call the meeting to order. And Mac, would you mind leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I'll continue with our mission statement. The Newmarket School District is committed to the highest standards of quality education by creating a safe and successful learning community that embraces diversity in response to the social, emotional, intellectual, and physical needs of every child. We are dedicated to fostering links to the broader community to ensure that students develop lifelong skills, enabling them to be contributing and productive members of society. And good evening, everyone. And this is the time for visitors to make comments. I don't see any, so we'll move straight to minutes. Is there a motion regarding the minutes for February 3rd?
I make a motion to accept the minutes from February 3rd.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Is there any discussion?
I think there is. No, there isn't on this one.
All right. Hearing none, then, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. And then the meeting on February 8th, the deliberative session. Is there a motion on that?
I make a motion to accept the minutes from February 8th.
I'll second that.
Any discussion?
Well, I wanted to ask Meg, on the top of page 3,
yep,
where it says, Meg Moore stated that it would quantify how safe this would...
Right.
You weren't really talking, that wasn't
no,
what you meant to say.
No, what I was saying, that the conversation was getting bogged down because
were
individuals
trying
trying to quantify how safe this would make our schools, when in essence what we wanted to do is comply with the directives from the fire marshal. Right. So I had that...
Oh, good. Okay. Yeah. So I don't know how we should change it. Should it be changed to somehow?
Yeah, because that's not what I said.
It's not really your intent.
And that's not what the board was trying to do.
No. What were you trying to say?
But my point was that the conversation was going into a direction that it didn't make any sense. Like, people were trying to say, well, how many kids will be more safe if...
Right. So it's almost like you said... stated that it's not that we're trying to quantify
right.
how safe
we're trying to comply.
We're trying to comply
right.
with the codes.
Right.
So I don't know what the nice succinct way of saying that.
You're a great wordsmith, so what?
It's we were not trying to quantify how safe it would make our building, but rather.
We were
put us in compliance.
Right.
Yeah.
And my point was, obviously, if you're taking a logical leap, it's most likely going to make more people safe.
Right.
But
yeah.
The focus of conversation. Well.
Do you have that, Jen?
As
long as she has it.
We're not trying to.
And you didn't take these, right, Penny? Did.
No, you didn't.
Yeah, so.
Okay.
Not trying to quantify
how safe it would make the building.
It's not possible for us to quantify that, right. Is the point.
Right.
And then instead of and, we put a but there, maybe, but we would be in compliance with the state.
Right.
Yes.
And that is why the school board voted for it.
As long as Jen has the right concept, I'm good with her.
Got it?
That was actually the point that the moderator made at the last meeting.
Mm-hmm. And I think that was the only, I don't know. On page 7, third line up from the bottom, Linda Montagani said if she felt strongly that we were not going to be able to offer these programs, she wouldn't have supported the cuts. I just think it makes it clearer, but I don't know. That's what you meant, right?
Yeah.
going to be able to, I guess is what I would add there, just a point of clarity. And that was it.
Okay, anything else?
Nope.
See those as just clarifying language, so I won't ask for an amendment or anything. So all those in favor of the motion with those changes, signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Okay. Dr. Hayes, you have some good news for us this evening.
We have several things for you. First of all, so excuse me, several things out of the elementary school. They, as you know, had a family snowshoe adventure night, which on February 9th, which sounded like a great time by all. There were 65 students, parents, and staff members, and they took an evening stroll through the woods to the high school. And Mrs. Miller and helpers had lighted the way with glow sticks hanging from branches.
So nice.
So it was kind of moonlit night. So it was really kind of a nice event, I think. So everybody enjoyed it. And then they had hot cider afterwards. Right?
Nice.
Very nice event on Friday the 11th. Mrs. Kumpf had arranged an assembly for all fourth and fifth grade students on bread making. It was an assembly put on by King Arthur Flour Company. The presenter with student volunteers showed the students how to make all sorts of yeast-based bread products, loaves, cinnamon rolls, etc. And then each student received kits, including everything they needed to make two loaves at home. So they were asked to bring one loaf back to the school, and we donated more than 140 loaves to the food pantry.
Wow.
Man,
that's
great.
That's awesome.
Last evening, the elementary school hosted a parent informational meeting on safe routes to schools. Parents learned about Walking to School Day on April 20th and about organizing neighborhood-based walking school bus groups. In addition, there are new procedures that are being put in place for riding bikes to the school, and so they went over that with folks. Third grade students will be following up their immigration studies with trips to the Lowell Mills National Historic Site on February 22nd and 24th. And the PTA will be sponsoring a teacher appreciation luncheon on February 23rd. A couple other things. On February 5th, I don't think that was on yours, was it? You'd mentioned it before. But the plunge, 16 high school students, two faculty members, and there were 34 schools participating this year with 348 plungers, and total raise was $65,000. So that was really, really terrific. Newmarket won the Super School Award for raising the most money, $4,100, in Division IV. And that's all. I'm going to leave that for Mac to speak to.
Who were the faculty members involved in the plunge? Was it Pat, Heath, and...
Ms.
Bryant.
That's awesome. It'll be hard to double the amount of money raised next year from...
You never know. This thing appears to be growing.
It just keeps growing,
you know,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
It's tremendous. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Mac, what's the student report this evening?
I'm going to start with sports. The boys suffered their first loss on Tuesday against Derryfield, which puts them still on top of the leaderboard at 14-1, but right below them is Derryfield at 14-1. So they're both tied for first, and looking like it, they're going to have a pretty good seat going into the playoffs. So.
Wow.
So, and they play Friday at PCA. And the girls are 8-9, and they're against PCA tonight, and tonight's their senior night, so it's all the girls' last home game, so I have a feeling it's going to be an emotional one. But if they could come back and have a big win tonight, they'll just keep boosting them up for the playoffs. On Friday, we have a high school dance from 7 to 10, and we're having a student DJ the dance. Yeah, Nixon Kunse, he's DJing, so that's kind of impressive.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, kind of excited. And the Poetry Out Loud, I believe, was a huge success. I was not able to attend because I had work, but I spoke with, Kelsey Bogaz was the winner, and I also spoke with other people that were there, and they all said it was a huge success. And the Death by Dessert was also last weekend, which was also a good success. And on Thursdays, the snowshoeing is still coming on, and I'm looking to actually participate in a few of this because it's a new activity that I would kind of want to pick up. I mean, I believe if they have enough students that are looking to play capture the flag or do something with it, just to make it even more that more enjoyable, so. And Mules Fever Week is next week, which is all a pep rally type week, so there's days like whiteout, redout, blackout, and support your favorite player day. So all the students will be participating in that, and on the end of the week, on that Friday, the faculty will be hosting a assembly for all the students performing skits just to end the week before break with a bang.
The faculty will be performing?
Yeah.
Oh. That's going to be worth
it. It's going to be a riot.
That's good.
And our break starts February 25th on that Friday after school. And also, we'll be able to look at our progress reports when we get out, because our progress reports come out February 25th as well.
Just before you go home on that night. Yeah.
Mom and dad.
On the refrigerator.
Yes. That's all I got.
Wow, that's a lot going on.
Any questions for Mac? All right. Well, thanks very much, Mac. And you're more than welcome to head over to support the senior girls on their last home game. And wish them well for us.
I will.
Cheer on our behalf.
Will do. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Excellent. So on to the rest of the superintendent's report.
Much of what I had in my report really refers to things that come up elsewhere in the agenda, so I'll pass over those until we get to them. Obviously, we have folks from the elementary, Scott Thompson and Joanne Lazarus, to talk about the new standards-based report guide for kindergarten. But the point that I wanted to make before they present is that we're not too far away from one for grades 1 and 2 as well. So I'm very happy to see that kind of progress. I think the report card, tonight's report card, for example, looks terrific. So. The other thing to mention, we have first reading policies coming up tonight. One of them is the Employee Assistance Program, and terrific changes to the policy. But what I want to tell you is that today we had Stephanie Marshall from the firm that provides all of our employee assistance, and she came and presented a workshop to as many district administrators as I could get. And it was all about your role as a supervisor in dealing with these personal problems, and then how to weave in the employee assistance program to help people. And so it was terrific. We were about an hour and a half. It was a terrific, terrific morning. So
great.
I want to mention that. That's all I have.
And I know the facilities committee hasn't met, and nor will they meet until
March 23rd. Right. And the other thing just to mention on facilities is that we're looking for any interested citizens who might want to expand our membership. I have added two people in the last couple weeks, and so make that a little bit more, I think, would be helpful. If people are interested, just send me an email, give me a phone call.
Do you think it would be worthwhile to maybe have a student or two?
Yeah, I think so. And I haven't reached that. I'd like to see people volunteer, but I've thought that, plus as well, I think some, at some point, adding some, other key leaders within the community, I think, because we need to continue to broaden out the representation. So yeah, student rep would be very nice.
Okay. Any other questions regarding facilities? Okay. Then let's move straight into program. We have a new standards-based report card that Jimmy just spoke of. Look forward to hearing some more about that. Good evening, Joanne.
Hello, how are you all? So I was here last 2 years ago when we rewrote our kindergarten report card. We changed it from more of a social report card to a standards-based skills report card. And one of the great things about education is that we continue to learn and grow and change. And so it's been a working document. And for the last 2 years, we've been using it. And we've discovered a few things that we felt we needed to change and tweak and make it more parent-friendly and teacher-friendly as well. I believe you both have, you have copies of the old one and the new one. So there's just a few changes in wording. We've condensed a few of the things we're reporting on because it became kind of redundant. And it's a great recording tool for the teachers, but it became a little excessive for a kindergarten report card for the parents. They wait, what did they do with the rhyming? So we kept, we squeezed a few things together and took out a few things that weren't quite as necessary. And we think it's become a much sleeker report card and easier to understand. And it's also on the Infinite Campus system now. We piloted that last year. So it's on the computer. Makes it easier, hopefully, to continue creating it. Has any questions about any of the changes?
Oh, I have a first question that's actually not a change, but it says grade 14 report card.
That's my pet peeve.
No, it's mine too.
I'll tell you. It's one of the great perks of the Infinite Campus is that it has a state reporting code for every grade. And rather than having a letter for kindergarten, they assigned the number 14. And apparently, in order to get that changed, it would cost lots of money to have that coding changed. So we are officially grade 14.
All
right. Top of the heap.
Preschool.
Yeah, preschool's 13. They get the unlucky number.
Wow.
So, yes. Yeah, so
you've been promoted. Just
yes.
Like
I know.
Top of the graph.
We're higher than seniors.
You get senior privileges?
Yeah, that's what I'm hoping. No off campus for them.
No.
Is this something that you're hoping to roll out for the next marking period?
For this coming one.
Okay.
Yes.
So what's still being used right now? The S and
Well, we actually don't do a report card for the first term in kindergarten.
Okay.
We do individualized progress reports script, basically, and meet with each parent individually.
Okay.
And so this is the first time the kindergarten parents will be seeing the report card, except we did show it to them at parent conferences and explain the rationale behind it.
Would there still be, like, scripts, or is this, like...
There is a comment section. One of the things about Infinite Campus is that you can actually put a comment underneath every single thing if you wanted to. So if I was doing those parts of the book, and I say, Johnny...
Give him an example or something?
Yes. Johnny does very well with this, or Johnny still struggles with reading left to right or right to left.
I really like the performance levels, and I'm curious how parents reacted to them. Last year, for example, when you used them?
Yeah, no, I think it was much easier for them
having
that than we've kind of always done that. And we're talking about switching to a rubric and doing the 1 through 4. And mm-hmm. But it does. It's much nicer, I think.
Good.
Well, secure, developing, and beginning, those are familiar to me.
Yes.
Yeah.
Those come home with the regular elementary school progress reports already, so that.
Right.
But I suppose if you're a kindergarten parent, this is
your first
exposure to it.
Yeah.
Right.
So you don't have the benefit of. Yeah. Okay.
No. So it does make it a little clearer. It's and we can also put the notes. We have not addressed this yet, or we'll be taught next term. I mean, there's a lot of things in kindergarten that we don't start in September.
Yeah.
We don't teach them to tell time in September.
Then they'll be like, is it time to go home?
Yeah. It's time for recess.
Can you speak a little bit to the parent involvement? You said that it's more user-friendly from the teacher as well as the parent standpoint. Were the parents involved with
We had parents involved with the initial switching from the social report card to the standards-based
uh-huh.
one. And we did get some parent feedback over the last couple of years. Especially after the first time it's going home for first-time parents calling up and saying, all right, I'm a little confused here. What does this mean when it says under social studies that, and so that was one of the factors that led us to think we need to do some better clarification on the wording anyways. But no, it was pretty much, we had the kindergarten team. Besides just the kindergarten teachers, we had special ed and all the OTs, so PTs and so it was an extended
mm-hmm.
team, but we didn't actually invite any parents to come in for this part of the process.
But those team members, I'm sure, brought the feedback that they had personally received from
Absolutely.
The parents that they talked to.
Yep.
Great. Other questions?
I have a broader question that goes beyond the kindergarten, so I might, Mr. Thompson, this might be directed to you. So for the modified program where it's a STAR, so you're identifying a student that I'm assuming is on an education plan, and I thought under FERPA that we weren't supposed to be doing that within the cumulative file. I don't know. I could be wrong, but something to check on?
Where's Jean?
Yes. It's your area of expertise, so we certainly ought to check on that. We've had provision for modified grades forever, I believe, in the elementary report cards.
Right.
So if that's something that we shouldn't be doing, we certainly ought to check
into
it.
Oh, just run it by Jean. I don't know if she's was involved in that in the academic performance levels, but...
No, we kind of just carried that over from the previous report card.
Yeah.
Check on that.
Okay. Thank you for that.
Yep. But I like this format. I think connecting it to the standards makes a lot of sense for...
Right. This is actually what we're doing during the day with your child, and this is what you're what we're seeing from your child.
Right.
So.
What is... I mean, I don't know if this is just a pure editorial type of thing. What is the reason for including all these, like, K-01, like, is that a requirement?
No, that is part of the Infinite Campus.
Okay.
And that's one of the issues we actually had using the Infinite Campus last year, where K has to be in there to be identified as the kindergarten, because we want to make report cards in for every grade level on that, and so we had to have a clarifying code number. And then we had the breakdown between social studies and math and so on. And then what we had done was assigned each of those standards that we were grading on a number. But when we went to grade in Infinite Campus, it took all the ones and put them together and all the twos. It didn't care what the M or the S or any of that. So when you went to enter grade, you had to have like all your reports on. Wait, next one. Okay, wait. Math. All right, go to science. Okay. So now we've changed it. So it's a we kept all of them ones that were going to be together. So all the reading grades, the literacy grades are together.
But so those codes have to show up in the actual published report.
They do. In order to have, the again, any visual changes to the Infinite Campus report card requires additional funding.
A lot more money than we have.
Yes.
Well, I do say, I mean, just looking at these two, I don't know what it is, but I like the portrait version much better than the landscape version. I don't know. It could just be me. I feel like this looks more familiar to what I've been used to seeing, the new one.
Yeah.
And I also like the way that the absence part,
it's broken
one,
apart, right?
It was like too cumbersome, you know, that would be a
I
little,
agree.
Yeah. So I like that. So I think it's much more pleasing to approach from a parental perspective.
Dr. Hayes, in your superintendent's notes, you had made reference to that the work that Mahesh Sharma has done in the district played into the new kindergarten report card, obviously specifically math. Can you speak a little to that, like how our professional development has influenced, you know, the math section of the report card? And
well, we actually added a section called Concept of Number Visual Clusters.
Right.
And that is a direct correlation to Mahesh and his guiding us on acquisition of math skills, especially at the pre-K and K level. And it's interesting because we really have put a big focus on that, and it's interesting to see the progress that's being made, in addition to use the everyday math, and it's given us a little flexibility there and really helps you identify which children are having number concepts and which are just kind of saying it by rote.
Sure.
So, so yeah, that is definitely in there.
Good.
Do the children actually grow plants and
yes.
stuff like they do?
Yep. In fact, right now, this week, we are, our Scott Forsman reading program, the book is, the big nonfiction book is called Seeds, which we kind of thought was humorous in February. But we are actually growing alfalfa seeds, and they'll be able to eat the alfalfa sprouts next week.
Good.
So, and then in March, when we come back, we actually grow leprechaun traps, and it's, you know, because there's no green in New Hampshire for St. Patrick's Day, leprechauns need green. So we grow grass, and, yeah.
They actually get a chance to go out into the wetlands and take a look around with that age group?
We really, I mean, I personally take my students out in, on the nature trail at least once per season. We go out and we look through and we explore. We hug and kiss trees because they're our friends. And we smell the different seasons and things like that.
you know, we try and incorporate it as we can, but we're limited because it is a 2.5-hour day, and we do have lots of academics and as much as nature and science is that to get the kids dressed and out and
this time of year.
Right, yes.
All right, anything else? Okay.
Great.
Well, thanks very much.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Did my keys work?
Way I want it.
So I wanted to just check it.
I'll be back.
Oh, they're gone.
Oh, they're gone.
So we'll just take a brief moment while we... Thank you for offering that so she can get... downstairs.
Any good jokes?
We're on TV.
Joan, do you have the copy of the manifest on your way?
Well, doing some of my research, that might be a good idea that we talk about this.
Okay, awesome.
You have them. A lot of school boards take a look at the invoices. Not that I want you to look at the invoices in the meeting, but I thought that maybe there's some school boards that they volunteer, they take turns coming in and just reviewing the invoices, because I think it's important for you to review the invoices to know kind of how your money's spent. And in addition, instead of having the check register run, I had the manifest run. I mean, you've been signing a check register. The manifest has more information. It has the vendor name, but it also has where it's charged, kind of what it is. So if you didn't want to come in and look at all these invoices, the manifest gives you more information, so I did do that. So I don't know if you want to kind of wait till the end.
We'll talk about that later.
Yeah. It's not going to be a quick one.
Yeah.
We good?
Sorry.
It's all right. So Pat's here to speak about the professional development program.
I just wanted to touch us on some things that we're doing within the district on professional development. Felt like this was a good time. I've outlined briefly, probably not so briefly, 2 pages. We start with a 5-year professional development plan that a group of people comprised of teachers, paraprofessionals, staff, other staff, could be an administrator, all talk about what are the goals, what do we look at long-term goals. The plan itself is more about how to get to those goals, what kind of courses can you take, what kind of paperwork to fill out, what are the goals of the district. Our new one will start, we'll have to start writing a new one next year. And I'm kind of excited because we can do a lot more with the whole technology aspect in terms of seeing how that's going to grow out 5 years from now. So here's where we start with professional development within district. We have all kinds. We have in-house professional development, which could take place just here within the district in-house.
we have job embedded, which means someone might come in during the day, and Mr. Thompson or Mr. Andruski will hire subs, and that person goes in and may model strategies while a group of teachers is sitting there. We've done that with Mahesh Sharma. He's gone to like a third grade classroom. We've had subs for substitute teachers for all the other third grade teachers. All the third grade staff, whether they're, you know, specialists or whatever, come in and watch a person teach a lesson. We then debrief about it, and they might go on to the next grade level. It's really good to see other people do strategies like that, and we've even done some peer modeling in that sense as well, not just specialists who come out of another place, but our own teachers do that for each other. We can use job embedded. We can go before or after school, and it could be a big group, could be a small group, could be one or two teachers who need to learn a specific skill. They might have been hired in the middle of the year, so we have to give them some more training. To Infinite Campus is a great example. They might not have been here when we first started, but they need to know how to use it, especially at the junior senior high school where they use it for a lot of their work. We have offered, it's called in-house professional development, but this summer we were lucky enough to offer Mahesh Sharma here for a whole week of professional development. I used some of our federal grant money to pay for his presence here and to pay teachers a stipend to come and attend here. We were also fortunate enough to have two other districts send teachers to us, and they paid a small fee for them to come and do the professional development, which was important because our staff got to network with other teachers who were using everyday math with Mahesh. So it turned out to be kind of a really cooperative learning experience. We also have early release days that you've been very kind of putting into our calendar that we can use for a variety of professional development. We can have speakers come in. We can do grade level work. We can do department work. As you know, for the junior senior high school, a lot of their early release time this year has been spent organizing their NEASC replies and surveys and summaries, because that's one of the few times where we can have everybody within the building sit down and be able to work together. You know, they're not off doing this job or that job. We're all together. Other things that we might do presentations on are employee benefits. We have the EAP people come in. They might talk about insurance. We have people come in and do presentations, especially for a particular department. The paraprofessionals always are asking for specific topics for their job performances, so we try to get those in as well. If you would like to take a workshop out of the district, you have an allotted money based on the collective bargaining agreement to spend, and most teachers are really big about spending that amount of money. We ask that when staff goes out of the district to a workshop or a conference, that they come back and share that knowledge, that new understanding, with either at a faculty meeting or it could be a curriculum meeting that I'm holding, because sometimes that's the best way to learn about, was that a really good workshop or was that not a really good workshop? Because sometimes, I mean, we all know, you look at the ad and, oh, it looks good on paper, but when you get there, sometimes it doesn't fulfill the need you thought it might. I often, since I started this job four or five years ago, spend time looking for workshops that I can expand with a large group of teachers across grade levels. That consistency is important. For example, in the fall, I used federal funds to send the entire math department at the high school to a conference. I think it was important that they go for 2 days, meet with other math teachers, learn some new strategies, talk about what was new, and they were very excited. First off, they've never been all together at one collective set time. It was really nice. We're doing the same thing with the English department in March. They're going to a literacy conference, and they're going to come back and take a half of, they come back on an early release day, and they're going to use that time to discuss and debrief each other and myself. We had 2 days of training this week downstairs. I took the social studies department at the junior senior high school and the science department at the junior senior high school, and I combined them with some staff from Mr. Thompson's building, and we learned about how to use vocabulary in the content areas. You know, how to not just throw out 20 vocabulary words, look them up, and know those definitions tomorrow morning. They spent 2 days with a woman presenter, Joan Sedita, from Key3 Learning. We've used her before. She does comprehension, which involves study skills and note-taking, and then this vocabulary strand. Again, it was really nice to have a whole department to be able to sit together for 2 days and talk about how they would use these kinds of strategies in their classrooms. You know, they actually got time to work and plan together as a group. It was very exciting. So they've done more and more of that. I think on page 2 I kind of briefly describe what Key3 is like. Meg brought up Mahesh Sharma. We have spent a great deal of time and money with Professor Sharma here. He's been extremely generous in terms of he's willing to sit after school and talk with people. We did the parent informational night. We had 30 people here that night. And some were from other districts. I know he's doing a workshop in Kennebunkport, so they sent 2 teachers down to kind of preview what he was about. People from Portsmouth came. People from Epping came. It was really important, I think, that parents got the chance to actually see and talk and ask him questions. He wasn't there the next morning. That was the day of the snowstorm the next morning, so he had, like, his bag packed next to him. It was very interesting. But he will be back in the district. He will start work with the middle school team at the end of March, and he will sit down and do similarly to what we've done at the elementary school in terms of sitting with groups of teachers and coming up with what we call non-negotiable concepts. Those are the core concepts at every grade level using everyday math and the New Hampshire standards, that if everybody does their piece of the puzzle, it all fits together. So he will start that work with middle school. I believe it's like the last week of March. He has been really good about going into the high school classrooms and talking to us about how we can reframe what we're doing. The other kind of training we've had in the district, we've started the obvious training. I know it doesn't look that way, but that's how you say it. It's not spelled that way. And that's to address the bullying and school climate issue that the state has asked us to develop a policy around. We had in December, we trained the entire junior senior high school staff, including lunchroom people, bus drivers, janitorial staff. Everybody got training. And then Mr. Thompson's building will get it March 18th. We'll do the whole building up there while we're doing something else at the junior senior high school. We have infinite campus training for my brand new teachers at the beginning in August. And then if anyone needs updates throughout the year, both buildings have tech integrators and coaches that are very good about, well, you know, if you come down during my free period, we'll work on working that through for you. We have used professional development time for mentoring, because that's an important, really important program here for our new teachers. Our veteran teachers have been trained in how to work with those new teachers and bring them through the process of becoming really comfortable within our district. We've done professional development this year with the State Department of Ed's program called Performance Tracker. And I'm going to eventually give you some kind of list, give you all these little details about what each of those programs does. Performance Tracker is on the State Department of Ed website, and it holds all of our data from assessments, student data, and we can go on that website and I can pull up, let's say, NEWA scores, our New England NECAP scores, Ames Web scores, another assessment, and you can see individual students, you can see groups of students. And then it's tied into also, if you all remember, we had TechPass, which was the curriculum mapping piece. The State Department of Ed took that piece over, we're still kind of working out some glitches, but it's still the same piece, and we give professional development training. Passwords are the big issue, but we're working through them. We've done summer trainings. We continue to do our early release days. We've been working with, just today, working on what the rest of the formats look for the remainder of the year. I know Mrs. Montagani asked about the paraprofessionals, and we just did a training on the Key3 strategies. We worked after school. I used a stipend to pay for those people who wanted to come. They worked for 3 hours, two Monday nights. We served them dinner, and it was a really nice event. They were very grateful. They had a great time, and they were very excited. We're going to work on them with math, I believe, during April. It's April. So we're bringing everybody up to... my goals have been to continually develop initiatives and strategies long-term in literacy K-12. And the more opportunities I can get to bring them all together to sit at the same table and realize they're not, you know, just junior, senior high, we're not elementary. What you do affects what you do, what you do. And it's working. The other goal I have is there is an infinite campus component that, of course, we have to buy. You've already heard that about infinite campus tonight. That would allow us to do our professional development online. There wouldn't be the onslaught of paperwork that poor Mrs. Barterman's going to get in about a month when everyone decides their certifications need to be done. And what happens is I've been in talks with the Rochester School District, who had the component built for their professional development plan. I wanted to do it for this year, but the advice I'm getting is that it would be easier if we waited till we had the new five-year professional development plan, because the forms might change and that would cost us more money. So what I might do is this year is take the plan and see how we can format it and then just fit our new forms once our new plan is written. But that's my goal, to get it all online so that we're not spending paper and losing things. And it's very simple. It's, you know, press the key and it comes to this building. It goes to administrator's desk. There's even a calendar component. So for example, if I'm going to professional development and it comes up on the calendar so that somebody can say, oh, they're going to something on math, or someone's doing something in science content. I've got to be sure we ask them about that. So we kind of know what everyone, not doing, but know where people are. And maybe there's, you know, maybe someone wanted to go to that, and next time they'll know, oh, I have to ask so-and-so because they went to that. That's that kind of open communication. So that's where we are with professional development. Pardon me?
Questions for Pat?
Pat, last school board meeting, I asked about staff development in a connection with SST. Is there anything in that five-year contract that we had with the state dealing something with vocational education?
Not for my part, no. No, this just pertains to my staff
right
here. But generally, I put out information like that to other districts saying we're doing this and this, and they'll
but in preparing the students for what's happening there in regards to staff development,
I don't do that here. No, we can look at how we could help with that. Certainly
I think we should.
Okay,
I really do. You know, that's something just going to throw out there.
What I'm saying is
are we doing enough in the computer tech area in terms of programming, a student's program? Are we preparing them enough for this? Is staff development preparing our teachers to prepare them to do this? I'm not sure. I'd like to see more of that myself in terms of what's really happening for the preparation of SST. SST is quite complex when you take a look at some of those tech programs over there. And I wonder, how are we supporting this? How many students we have that are going into programming?
And I think
not,
that changes
why
every year.
If they're not, why? Because I would think that's what we want them to do.
I know when Mr. Pavlidis, Mrs. Winterbottom, any of the administrators sit down with each group as it comes time to go through the program of studies, they look very carefully to make sure that it's a good fit. You know, are we sending them, and are they ready to go there? I think they work very hard at that, but we'll certainly check in with each other and make sure that's an ongoing process.
So I'm trying to understand, you're curious if our professional development is in alignment with the professional development of the staff at SST?
No.
Or?
No, what I'm saying is, if you take what she's doing, and she's given workshops to prepare our teachers for the mathematics taught at Newmarket High School or the junior high or the elementary school. Well, what are we doing to prepare besides our shop areas, which is preparing the students for SST? Because the teachers have told me, they said, don't stop that program. Newmarket students are the only ones that can swing a hammer. And so I'm saying the same thing, saying, what do we do with computerization? So when I talked to the fellow down here, and I had a long conversation and actually a walkthrough, and asked him, how many students in Newmarket are taking these programs? He says, not enough. And I said, well, what's going on? They should be going crazy with this stuff, what they have over there.
So that's not necessarily professional.
Well, it is. It is professional.
Our offerings in terms of, so you're speaking kind of specifically to like computer programming.
No, I'm talking about other the medical tech that they're offering there. Are we preparing our teachers to teach preparing students to go there for that? There's other programs that I think we should look into and see if we are preparing our students. Are our students saying, I'm not going to go there because I don't know what's going on?
Wouldn't that mean that we have to add classes to our curriculum?
Not necessarily, no.
So to maybe help me understand, as we prepare, as we try to have a coherent curriculum from grade 6 to 7,
yeah,
and then from 7 to 8 in mathematics,
right,
we need to have coordination so that if a student was going to be involved in a medical technology program at SST, that the courses that they have prior to them going there prepare them adequately for that.
Yes.
That's where you're coming from. So
we need to offer presentations to our teachers to help them.
No, I think is our curriculum heading in the right direction to prepare the students for all the opportunities, not just saying they're all going to go to college. Like I said before, these students go to college, only 30% graduate from college. And the push in the country is vocational education.
So you're saying what we need to do is, as part of our professional development, make sure that we're considering not just history being consistent from this grade to that grade, but whatever the fundamentals, whether they be technical drawing or mathematics or
culinary, whatever.
Right, those are consistent. We're having the conversation with the staff.
Yes.
At SST.
Yeah. Well, yes. Yeah. Whether they should give more talks and tell us what's going on, some sort of communications for the students if they desire something, are they ready for that particular program? That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, well,
and I think the staff development is designed to do that, to prepare the teachers for all the opportunities for students.
Yeah, what might be interesting is to maybe talk to some of the folks at SST and say, okay, in the computer technology program, what skills do you find that might be lacking, not just here at Newmarket, but at other districts,
just generally,
that if we, kind of built a little, our curriculum around it a little bit more, the students would be stronger in this area, that kind of thing.
I'm not saying to turn the leaf over on, instantly. I'm saying let's take a look and see what we're doing with our curriculum, besides trying to send them all to college. It's nice for all students to go to college, but all our students probably should go to college. Some should probably go into the vocational areas.
I think what we've tried to do in professional development, especially in the past 2 to 3 years, where we've been accountable to the state for AYP and Denise, we've really looked at the basic fundamentals and foundations of learning in literacy and math for all students, so that they're successful no matter what their vocational path is, whatever they choose when they graduate from high school. And that's a concern you hear from all of our teachers, no matter what they're teaching. They need to do, let's say, better in math, or we need to improve so that they're writing, whether it's a lab report, a bill for something, they need to be able to be successful at doing that. Once they have those foundations, we can expand upon them, but I think we're still working at making sure everyone has that foundation. And you've got to remember, we get new teachers every year that we kind of have to pull along that way. Math department's seen some big changes in the last 2 to 3 years, and it's tough sometimes. So, but I will check into that, Chuck.
Okay.
Any other
thoughts or questions? I just have one quick question. Pat, are you finding the half-day model effective in the teacher's skill acquisition? Are you getting any feedback, or do you have a sense, is this working well as opposed to like full-day?
This has been a tough year for that because the district-wide, only because the junior senior high school has been so, you know, caught up in the NEAS process. That's been their time to use for that. And it's difficult to do anything K to 12 during that halftime period. So we've kind of had to adjust things. I love having a whole day of professional development. That just makes scheduling so much easier, and you know, it works really nicely. But that's up to how the program is, you know, you decide how to use those days. We try to squeeze in moments, you know, whether it's my curriculum meeting times during the month, or even before, as I said, we have meetings sometimes that start 6:30 in the morning at the junior senior high school, because they start school at 7:20. But they're willing to come in and work on computer stuff, or work on mapping, or just have a general discussion about homework. But we still need that link so that they're not still two separate buildings, that they, you know, they merge and they see where each other comes from. That was the importance of having people down there from both buildings this week to work on literacy. I think they both got a taste of where the end line is, and how do you get to the end line isn't quite as easy as it looks on paper someday. It's that conversation that we don't get to do all the time.
So it may be helpful when the board reviews a calendar for next year. I know we've already approved that for next year.
Right.
The following year, just a recommendation on what you think would be most beneficial for our teachers here in the district, and we could use that as part of our decision making for professional development.
Right.
That'd be a good conversation. Thank you.
The professional development, or those half days, are fairly consistent among all, actually looping back to SST, many of the SST sending schools, right?
Does it go down to that? We're pretty consistent with most districts.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of other districts have a set. It's like every other Wednesday in the month. It's, you know, that's just how they do it. There are some districts that start out in September with a Monday, then October's Tuesday. They go through that way so that parents for daycare issues can plan a little differently. The only day that sometimes is hard would be a Friday afternoon early release day. I'd have to drum up a really good speaker for that afternoon. The half day is pretty consistent throughout, as Cliff said, throughout the surrounding districts. But a full day does work really well.
So we're in year, I'm sorry,
I'm
we're in the fourth year?
4 years. Next year will be the last year, but by the end of last year, my new one would have been approved so they can start. The reason they do that is so that people that would take professional development over the summer would be carried over into the new format. So it's usually sent to the State Department of Ed May 1st, and they promise to have it back and approved by June 30th of the same year.
So that's a process you're probably starting to roll on?
It'll start in the fall. I'll start putting together a group. But the emphasis, I know, is already going green up there. You know, put everything you can on your website.
Less paper. All right. Any other questions? Okay.
That's great.
Thanks very much, Pat.
Thank you.
Okay. Free and reduced lunch report.
First, I'd like to apologize because I don't have the report. Linda had a coordinated review this week from the State Department, so she will be at your next meeting with the exact numbers. But our numbers have not changed.
Okay.
Hardly at all. And actually, Pat and I talked about the Title I numbers. They've basically been static for a couple of years, which makes me feel like we're not doing enough outreach to get the word out to people that this is available to them.
I met with Linda last week to kind of talk about, you know, what the issue seems to be, and I didn't find the forums easily accessible on either website. Kind of had to go through, you know, some steps, go to the handbook, you know, at the schools. And Linda suggested something which I know that we used to do in Beverly, and I don't know if we were still doing it in Beverly, but when the first aid packet goes home, you have to come back with the medical card and this and that. They have to come back with the free and reduced lunch form signed. I'm interested and it's filled out, or I'm not interested and signed, because that way then we make sure every home got one. And as the kids get older, if you're not required to bring it back and, you know, throw it in a pile or whatever, or parents don't have, I know as a parent I had a sign that I wasn't interested, so at least I got to see it. So I think that maybe is something we can put in place for September.
I think that at one point in time we used to have to sign it. Mm-hmm. And then
so at least we know you saw it.
Makes good sense.
Yeah.
So I think that's something, you know, we might want to post it, the forms on our website, you know, on the district website rather than just the school websites. And I think some outreach from the guidance counselors, from the nurses, because they tend to kind of know the families that might be struggling, whereas maybe the office doesn't, or the teacher maybe doesn't, but sometimes families, you know, will share with the guidance counselor, or they can see in a kid that there's issues and they can ask the question. So I think just more outreach is what we really need to do, because not only does it increase our free and reduced lunch reimbursement, it helps with our Title I funding. Mm. You know, it really drives.
And it helps families.
Helps
right.
families.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Thinking as a business manager,
right.
helps that funding.
It's a benefit they're entitled to.
Right.
And
I think
many,
people would be quite.
Known enough.
Mm-hmm. I would encourage people who are watching at home to if you think that, I mean, just to fill it out, because the worst that happens is that you're not eligible. But I think people would be surprised that if you have a big family, how high the threshold is for your earnings. And it's just based on earnings, period.
You know, this would be, to me, a great thing to send a mass email out to all parents, saying, you know, just a reminder, we offer this, here's the paperwork, you know, just explain, you know, and maybe you can, you know, just put a cover letter in, here's the deal,
right.
And, you know, it's worth taking a look at. And
it's huge. I mean, the free, obviously, there's nothing, you know, no charge, but then the reduced is really reduced.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not much at all. So, and that threshold, obviously, is even higher for what your income can be, and I think people would be quite surprised today. So, yeah, that's a great idea. So Linda will be here at the next meeting to talk about, you know, to give you the chart and to show you, but I really think that we need to do a better job trying to get people to participate.
Mm.
So I thought she had a good idea about having the sign off.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great idea. I hate to have to wait until September to do that, but maybe that makes sense.
So I'm not sure that you could pull that off now, send an email,
yeah.
waste of paper and whatever. But, I mean, if we send the email out.
By email.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Post it on our website, too.
But I think that the other piece is, you know, to ask for a free and reduced lunch form if you're a new student or maybe life circumstances has changed, is you have to go to the office. If they could pull it off of website and just mail it in to the food service director, and nobody in the office knows, you know, none of the staff know, and it's confidential. And I think sometimes it's people's pride. You're in a small town.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
they don't want to go in and ask for the form. So that's a great idea, and we'll put it on the website.
And put it on the website, not buried deep on the fourth page of food service, but a link right on the top. Great.
Good.
Excellent. So we'll look forward to that. Next time, and we have some job descriptions then is our next step.
Yes, there are two job descriptions here for your approval, and again, especially the approval because it's an evaluation instrument as well, and then for related service providers as well as related service provider assistants, and my experience is that in trying to do separate ones for occupational therapist, physical therapist, speech and language pathologist. There's a lot of similarities, even though there are different areas that they provide services in. And so what we've done is framed a job description that merely speaks to the service, whether it be speech or occupational therapy and whatnot. And so it gives a good job description as to what, for providers, what do they do in terms of responsive services, how they have to act as a consultant, how they communicate, what they do for administrative and other professional responsibilities. And then that plays off to related services provider assistant. We have occupational therapy assistants, physical therapy assistants, speech and language assistants. And so there's kind of dovetails, the whole thing dovetails together very well. So we really, really have six job descriptions and six evaluation instruments here is how we look at it, but it's very streamlined. And the union has certainly had its review of the service provider job description, and as for assistance, I asked Gene Parsons to meet with or share with the assistants this information, get their feedback and reactions to it, and everything's been pretty positive, so that's why it's here for your approval.
Okay, any questions or any thoughts about this?
Makes complete sense.
It's nice that the evaluation tool matches so closely with the job description. It makes it very clear what the expectations are, and there's a lot of them. I mean,
yeah, that's not.
When I think about an occupational therapist, I think about little I know of the field, but I'm in my
direct
mind,
delivery of service.
Yes, a direct service with students, but that's only one or two of the bullet points.
Right.
Where there's so much with coordinating, communicating.
Right.
IP meetings and
professional development. They have to
right down to item number 30.
Mm-hmm.
So it was eye-opening for me to think about
real,
it. That.
Yeah, and what's nice is that for all of our people to be able to give them some real clear direct feedback on how they're doing or where they need to improve. That's what I really like the most about this. So that because typically you don't have instruments like this and people strain to figure out, well, how do I give good quality feedback?
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is something that really helps.
Is this the evaluation similar to the layout of the ones that we developed or you developed?
All
or?
The others, yeah. I mean, one is really following that Danielson model, but all the others I've given you.
So, yeah, it's nice to have them all streamlined.
It's very
like
similar,
that.
Yeah.
Like that.
And more to come, school nurse, guidance counselors, those are, I'm getting near to the point where I can share those with the union, so we'll have those soon. So, again, same format.
So these have all been through the teachers?
The one that belongs in the teacher's bargaining unit has been, yes.
Good.
All right, so are you looking for action?
Yeah, I think you should approve them as you do other evaluation instruments.
Anyone want to offer a motion in that regard?
Do we have to do them all individually?
You can do the two together.
Okay, I'll make a motion to approve the job descriptions for the related services provider and the related services provider assistant, as well as the evaluation tools.
I will second that motion.
Okay, any further discussion?
Is this got anything to do in regards to policies? Can this be tied into policies? Is the policy of us to have a piece of material like this? I'm not sure. I'm just throwing something out there, Jim.
Not in a real direct sense. I mean, one of your responsibilities as a school board, I think, is to authorize the system of evaluation. Clearly, you did that with a teacher model, and that got a lot of play because it affects a lot of people, and that's why I bring these individually for your approval, because I see them as a piece. But beyond that,
policies that said that we will evaluate,
right? So to me, that's where the policy comes in, and obviously it makes sense as a school board to have an up-to-date set of job descriptions for all your employees, and that's what we're trying to do.
All right.
Any other thoughts? Okay, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
Opposed? Okay. On to correspondence.
correspondence. You may recall some time ago I wrote a letter of support for Newmarket's Head Start program in the hopes that it would remain at the rec center. There was some threat that it may not. And so just the other day I got a response back on where things stand, and things are moving forward, which is, as you can see here, that you know, the key players that need to come together do plan to meet, and I sense in the letter a good degree of optimism. I mean, it's not a final decision, but a good degree of optimism that it can happen. I actually spoke briefly the other day with Jim Hilton when I was meeting with him on something else, and I think there's, again, that sense of optimism that we'll find a way to keep it here. So I thought you should see that.
Thank you.
And you're welcome. And then the other one that I know has already been shared here, but the Hampshire School Boards Association has a scholarship program for children of school board members. So just made everybody aware.
Children and grandchildren.
Right. Yeah, I was surprised to see that. I didn't know that it applied. I could have, you know, could have taken advantage of it when my dad was on nothing. Oh, well.
Okay, Joan, I'm ready now for you. You're gonna get us with some thoughtful changes on how we do business.
Okay. First, let me just go through the where we stand with the FY11 budget. Our revenues are pretty much on target, except I'm a little worried about the Medicaid number. We've only received $45,000 to date. We budgeted $150,000. If it trends anything like it did in Massachusetts. We got tons of money in June. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm jumping the gun. I'm just, you know, watching it, a little worried. Should be similar because we have the same kids out of district. You know, we basically have the same students this year that we had last year that qualified for Medicaid. I don't feel like the special ed office was worried about it, but you know, I'm worried because we have some high expenses on the other side that I'm worried about. So that's it for revenues. On the expense side, although I see some you know, overages, our legal expenses is overspent right now by $15,000. And our insurance buyout, I don't think we budgeted appropriately because we're over about $15,000 on that. But I guess you really can't tell if somebody chooses to go on their spouses and they get the insurance buyout. It's really not something you can budget for. And our sped transportation right now is projected to be over by about $12,000. So, I mean, all in all, I guess that's not too bad. We're doing okay in sped contracted services right now with all the encumbrances that of everything they know today. We have $44,000 sitting in that account, so that makes me feel a little bit better about the Medicaid. And again, we didn't fill the speech therapist position, so her salary, the $37,000 plus all the benefit piece, that's sitting there too. And the only other area that I see that we have some surplus money in will be the we had money left over in the roof and modular projects. Not a lot, maybe about $30,000, but at least I'm feeling like that will balance. I guess I'm telling you this because we had put so much effort into talking about all the surplus that we were going to put into all those reserve funds, and I don't really feel like that's going to be there. Time will tell. We're doing pretty good with our fuel, though, so that makes me feel better. So, we're only 37% spent, and it's already mid-February. And we had a very cold winter, so hopefully we have a warmer spring. And that's what these manifests all in. So the fuel bill, there's fuel bills in there, so that's all considered in there. So I guess I'll go right into food services based upon the fact that we will be using that contingency money that was budgeted. And I'm happy that it was budgeted because we are running a deficit right now of about $22,000. Projected out. So again, that would help if we had free and reduced lunch numbers up. We could increase participation. It's, you know, one of my goals to try to be able to resolve that issue, but it's not easy to change and not easy to find a solution to it.
So. I was at the school for bingo a week or so ago, and Linda showed me that she had to get a new refrigerator, although she was able to get a great deal on a used one, but
and she had someone volunteer to remove it because it was going to cost almost as much to remove the old one.
Yeah. So
putting effort in, it's just, you know, it's really hard, and they're changing the nutrition guidelines again, which is great for healthy kids, but it's really hard to get, you know, kids to eat what we're going to be allowed to sell. The vending machine is not going to be allowed to have hardly anything starting next year. Mm-hmm. So it's difficult to funny. I did meet with her the other day. We talked about maybe doing some advertising. I hadn't really been in the cafeteria since the first day I toured the school, and there was nothing up on the walls. And yeah. I know there are some there's fire issues, but I mean, there's some portion of the walls that we could do ads and to have that new banner going now, electronic mm-hmm. banner. So I said maybe you could do a special up there or something. Just try to get some excitement. I know a lot of the companies, they send the big posters of the athletes with the milk mustache, and you know, maybe you could just try to get some interest that way. So, and I think Dan and Yogurt had just sent her a whole, you know, whole slew of stuff to kind of put up and get kids interested. So we're working on it. But Linda will be here at the next meeting. Again, I apologize. We thought she was going to be able to come, and then she had her coordinated review pop up on her. So we're going to stay on the topic of the business side. I was kind of popping around in other New Hampshire school districts' websites, kind of see, you know, what they do for this, because I was very used to a school board that came in and reviewed the invoices every week. Some districts, it appears that they that the school board does. Other districts, it's clear that they don't. They just look at the manifest and sign it. Some districts have representatives, and they rotate through. That one representative goes in, kind of reviews the invoices, asks questions if they have questions, but the whole board signs the manifest. So I don't know if it's something you want to think about maybe putting in place for next year. I think it's important. I know it looks terrible, but I think it's important sometimes to see where the money's spent, so that when you're out in the community, you understand how expensive, really expensive, sped transportation is. It isn't just something I'm sitting here telling you. Mm-hmm. You could see some of the bills and stuff like that. I think it was very informative. We went over to that model in Beverly, I don't know, 2 years ago, and I know I was quite frightened, like, oh no, what are they going to be asking me? But they really became educated about where their money's being spent, mm-hmm. so I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing.
When I first started on the board, we used to get all of the invoices to look through. And then we appointed, I don't know, do you remember, we appointed two people that would go in and review them and then and sign off, and then we would just sign off. And I think that was kind of the model we were supposed to be using, but we've just kind of
drifted away
from it, so.
It's your call. I mean, I think you can do it either way. But tonight, Jimmy, we're out of the room tonight. Typically, they get a check register. Yes. Tonight, they have it's really the manifest. So it shows the account number, kind of a little description of what the invoice is for. So mm-hmm. you don't have to read them all, flip through it tonight. But I would like you to think about if you want to change the procedure. I think it's a bad idea.
It's definitely worth considering having a closer eye on it. I know that as chair, I need to sign the big POs, you know, over $15,000. So I have the big ticket items I generally see, and have a sense of that. But that's not where all the money
adds up.
A few for $15,000 is nowhere near a significant percentage of the total budget.
I know that in my previous position, I think that the special ed bills really impact you. When you see, I mean, we can say we have a kid that's going out for this or going out for that, but when you see, you know, a couple of names on a bill and the amount of money it costs, it really.
And the transportation, for example.
Transportation is huge. Yeah. Huge.
Boggling.
Something to think about. And then the last thing is Jim decided, you know, Jim and I talked, and we had a different structure before and where I came from, and we had subcommittee meetings. So we had finance and facilities every month. So we kind of like just did all this stuff at finance facilities. So I said to Jim, you know, maybe that we should be giving you information about our current facilities, not all the talk about building new facilities, but our current facilities in case you're out in the community. People want to know what happened with the heat. I know Jim does a really a great job of getting the information out to you. But so I met with Brian, and we're going to start meeting every other week, and he's just going to give me a rundown of where we stand, what we had, whatever. So I do have something to hand out. I'll wait till the meeting's over so you can look at it. But it's just kind of a recap of what's been going on in facilities. We hired, I'm sure everybody saw all those awful stories on the news. We had a school in Beverly issues with their roof, but we hired roofers.
to come in that very next day after the predicted snowstorm, and they spent 3 days clearing the snow from both schools. We did have a leak at the elementary school. We had leaks in both the old and new portables. They were remediated, and the leaks in the new portables were occurred because of an ice dam, and it was just like everybody's home had issues, but there was no damage to the interior. Over the Christmas break, just kind of as a recap, they corrected some of the safety, fire safety issues. They installed exit signs in the library. That was one of the recommendations. And they added fire extinguishers that was addressed in the report. Now each wing has 3 extinguishers. They're planning to do their typical vacation week cleaning, 2 weeks or week, I guess, week. At the high school, we did the same with the roofers. We had a day that we had no heat. Last week, the heat was off for 4 hours. Students stayed in school. It was a failed circulating pump that was the cause. It was replaced immediately. There was no damage. There was no water breaks, even though it was freezing. It wasn't off long enough. Luckily, it wasn't off long enough to do any damage. And we have purchased a replacement air tank. We purchased that after the leak that we had in the fall, November. So we purchased it then. Then we had the cold weather, and the company said that they wouldn't touch it. If it continues to stay warm, they're going to do it on the winter vacation. If not, it'll have to wait till April vacation. And that will do a couple of things. It will make us more efficient, but we currently have a sump pump pumping water out of the boiler, out the door. That's what we do every day, trying to keep that boiler running. So hopefully that will get taken care of on the vacation. They're going to be doing the cleaning over winter break as well. And then after we got the bill for the roofers, Brian suggested that they have these awesome sleds, he called them. They're snow shovel sleds that the roofers use.
Pushers.
Mm-hmm. So we ordered them and we bought them. So if we have another big snowstorm, we can get our own people up there to do the sleds and not have to be at the mercy of those roofers that had a lot of business in the last couple of weeks. The other one thing I want to report is that I have scheduled both Brian and the lead custodian at the high school, Bob French, are going to a 2-day training in Laconia the first week of March, and it's their first training they've been to, So it's the New England Facilities Masters Conference. I think it's just a great opportunity for them. I'm going with them. They're going to have a whole thing on safety, fire safety, the whole safety plan, all the new ADA requirements that that we have to adhere to. So I attached on the back of this memo the schedule, so you can see kind of what they'll be learning when they go.
Great. That's wonderful.
Yeah, they're very excited.
Good.
Kind of push a little. Oh, that's our vacation week. We have to strip our floors. I said, well, we'll figure that out. But
we'll have someone do that.
That's what I said. It's really important for them because they haven't, I mean, I don't know what kind of structure you had in place before, but I mean, Brian especially should be getting this information because there's so many rules and regulations with schools that, you know, he really needs to know and understand. So excited that they're going.
Where is that training?
It's in Laconia. It's the Northern New England Facilities Masters Conference. They have it every year. People from Beverly used to go. I actually got it through my old email, and I jumped on it, and it wasn't expensive. It was $150 a piece, and Primex offered one free.
Okay.
So as our part of our risk program, so yeah.
Nice.
That's it for me.
Thanks. Sure.
Joan and Jim, probably can we keep an update of what's happening with the governor's budget, how it's going to affect us? Can we each meeting give us a little whatever you got?
Do that. It comes faster than that. Even. Yeah. What I've tried to do is when I get in. Good information through email, I send it out in an email.
Yeah, you've been sending us. Yeah, that's good. It's been helpful.
Not good.
No, it's not. No. It's not good, but it's one of those where you really have to stay tuned because it's a long process. Yes. His is just a proposal, and there are a lot of steps along the way.
The last go through the House and the Senate and so forth.
Right, committees and so.
The two things that Jim asked me about, one is the sounds like they're not funding the building aid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Not even about new building, the current.
Yeah.
So we all got letters today. Did you send me that letter? We
I
got
gave
a letter
a copy
today.
Of that, yeah.
We were not supposed to get anything, so it doesn't have any effect on us, right, but for districts that were supposed
some
to
districts
get.
Got noticed today.
I can't imagine. Can you imagine?
Exactly. That we're not, they're not going to get the money they were promised.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, yeah.
The other piece
in case it's confusing to folks at home, these are people who already had approved projects, multi-million dollar projects that they're expecting reimbursement, and now the state is...
They've already probably started the projects.
That's right. Yeah. Oh, absolutely. They're already paying bond. Yeah. They're already paying. And now the state
some have already built.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
And the other piece that's very worrisome is their contribution to the retirement system. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That governor's budget said zero. And we perhaps won't know what it would mean to our budgets until June.
June.
Well, we talked a little bit about it today at the charter school. I think it's like 30-70 right now. The houses want to get it 28-72, something like that. But they're going down. But then they go back up to 35-65. So they're kind of going up and down, trying to adjust things. That's what I'm concerned about is, you know, where's that going to put us, or the taxpayers?
Well, in the memo that came out from Jim's organization said that, you know, every district will look at more layoffs than that you had in your budget because you have to find the money, and your budget will already be passed.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
There's no other way.
I'm trying to recall the number that increased in that line item on our current budget based on what was projected. Some $80,000 or something, more than the year prior.
I don't know.
It was very. It was. I mean, $80,000 is a lot of staff. And if it's much worse than that, I mean, no matter what happens, it's the obligation goes to the taxpayer, the property taxpayer.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the rubber will meet the road. So hopefully that will not be as doom and gloom as it sounds.
Yeah, I'd like us to talk about it sometime like this at the meetings, what happens when we see something come up, so we're all kind of on the same page.
Yeah.
It's nice to read it on an email, but I'd like to consult with people.
Do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, off to policies then. Oh, no, never mind, sorry. We have a pile.
They've been busy.
Yes, we have. You have, excuse me, gosh, frog. You have three policies that are here for first reading. The first one obviously shows significant change, meaning the current policy is almost completely struck out and replaced in bold with a new policy. And this deals with the employee assistance program. We learned, and Joan can perhaps tell you more because it really came through a meeting Joan had, that we needed a much clearer policy on the employee assistance program. So this is the recommended policy that was given to us. And it is a lot clearer. And again, after today's workshop, made it even more important to have something of this sort so that you can make it very clear to anybody who might be in a position to be imparting information about this that they understand the procedures and the roles. And so it's anything else you want to comment about that, Joan?
Answer questions if they have.
Okay. One of the things that we talked about, for example, and it's at the end of the policy, that we talked about at the training this morning is a concern that employees may very well often not take advantage of this assistance, which is free, because of concerns about confidentiality. Once you really understand that, there are people out there who think that all those reports give specific information, and it all comes back to the SAU office, and it's not at all the case. That the only thing the SAU office gets at the end of the year is a utilization report. How many individuals were processed? Doesn't really tell you much more than that. And beyond that, it's really the employee and actually the employee and any member of their household. So it's just a terrific, terrific program, but this policy really helps to really clarify what's the district's approach, philosophy and approach to this. The other two that are here for a first reading both deal with student activities funds. The first one, as you can see, policy JJF, is really just a little bit of extra language. I can't say that it changes it a whole lot, except it is more explicit with what the principal has to do. The principal has to establish administrative regulations to carry out the policy, and that's why there's this new policy, which is JJF-R, meaning it's related to JJF, and it gives very clear direction as to what needs to be done, who's responsible in the conduct of these student activity funds. So it's I think it'll be very useful to our principals and good guidance if we run into problems. Any questions on any of those? The remaining ones are here for a second reading, and so looking for your approval of these. The first one is hiring of non-certified personnel. As I mentioned to you last time, this is a new, first of all, this is a new policy. It's not an existing policy, but it was recommended that it be employed by the School Administrators Association and obviously the School Boards Association. And what it does for non-certified personnel is it effectively puts the responsibility for selection and hiring, recruitment and hiring, in the hands of the superintendent as opposed to the school board. So that when this, and that provides a variety of protections, I think, for you and the school district. So it did make a great deal of sense to do that. The change that would be visible to you is that in the future, I wouldn't be coming in and asking for your nomination and all of that, but I'd simply be coming with a list to notify you that these are the non-certified people that I've hired. The other things that are significant in here is in the second paragraph under application. It says, if hired, applicants will be required to show evidence of a satisfactory physical examination. When you first looked at this, it said custodial and food service positions only, and since that time we found language in state law that says everybody is required. So it's all employees. The last thing that's very important is that we've operated as a district thinking and acting like non-certified people are at-will employees, when in reality we weren't explicit enough about it, and it created problems for us. So both in the policy and in the applications that are joined to this, we're very explicit about that. So that's here for your approval. Do you want me
to do these one at a time?
I think we should treat them individually.
Yeah, let's. Okay.
So we make a motion to adopt, is that the appropriate word, policy GGF, hiring of non-certified personnel.
I'll second that.
Okay. Any discussion? All right. So the final version will have the strikeouts and things.
Yes. Yeah. I take the edits out and take the bold out.
And add an adopted date.
Yes.
At the bottom.
Yep.
I think it's very clear and a compelling case for its need, so I'm certainly in support of moving forward with this. Any other thoughts? Okay, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
Thank you. The next policy is very related to it. It says it's a current existing policy called employment of non-certified personnel, and as you can see, there are very few edits to this. In the first reading, the first paragraph merely read, it is the policy of the school board to recruit, select for employment, etc. And you wanted me to be explicit, and hopefully that language makes it clear that it's the superintendent's responsibility per this policy, GDF. The other thing, again, is the language relative to everyone having to show evidence of a satisfactory physical examination. And then at the end, the at-will basis language is included in this policy as well.
Is there a motion on this policy?
I'll make a motion to accept policy GDB as presented.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Opposed?
Thank you. The next policy is existing policy in corporal punishment. And as you can see there, there's language that has been struck from this policy. The language specifically refers to physical restraint. Changes in new state laws have required then a new policy on use of restraints, and that's the next one to come. So this is just cleaning up language in corporal punishment so that we can create the new policy.
Make a motion to accept policy JKA on corporal punishment as presented.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
And the next policy is an extensive policy, necessarily so by the law, and obviously the acts we'd be taking. It's relative to use of restraints, and it gives definitions and procedures and when restraint may be used and prohibitions, so it's very clear language. And once this gets approved, obviously it'll be shared with all the pertinent staff.
I'll make a motion to accept policy JKAA, use of restraints, as presented.
I'll second that.
Any discussion?
On the first page, circumstances in which restraint may be used, it should probably just be restraint.
I'm sorry, where are you here?
No, that's not it.
No.
Oh, Lord.
I'm sorry. That's the second page, his first page.
In which restraint?
Yes, restraint. Thank you. Good catch. Yeah.
I'll consider that non-substantive. Any other thoughts? Okay, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you. The next policy is a revision of an existing policy entitled Student Discipline of Out-of-School Actions. And the language that is being struck from this, this is cleaning up a policy. The language being struck refers to cyberbullying and internet threats. And as you recall, we already fairly recently approved a new policy in that regard. So it's just cleaning this up so that our policies are consistent.
I'll make a motion to accept policy JICDD on student discipline out of school actions as presented.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Thank you.
Opposed?
And the last policy is a new policy dealing with indoor air quality. Again, it's the RSAs require that we have such a policy, and to me it's a good thing. I think it's requiring action and attention, if you will, by the schools on air quality in schools. And so it coincides with the RSAs.
Is this a model policy from the...
From the School Boards Association, right.
Okay, is there a motion on this policy?
I can make a motion to adopt policy EBBD on indoor air quality as presented.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed?
Thank you.
Yes, one more?
I'm sorry, I do have one more for you. and it's admission of non-resident students and tuition. Not sure how I stumbled across this, but realized that we have a policy. Some of the language is outdated. Certainly, it's not something that we use these days. We're not admitting students for tuition, but in any case, I thought we should have the right language in the policy.
I'll make a motion to accept policy JFAB as presented.
I'll second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Opposed? Okay. And do we have any resignations this evening?
I do not. Have a nomination.
I put those better.
Materials at your seat before the meeting started. I present to you for your approval Craig Stevens for a position as teaching assistant at the junior senior high school. As you see from his background, he's a bachelor's and well on his way to getting a master's degree and has been a teaching assistant in two other schools here on the seacoast. And so I'm pleased to present him for your approval.
Will probably be our last one that we do.
This is it, I think. Yes. It will be easy, a little bit easier next time.
Can we strike out that Social Security number so he won't leave this room? I'm not happy to see that.
In fact, maybe we can all hand this back to him.
Yeah.
I'm not happy to see that at all.
Yeah. All right.
A little outdated application there.
Yeah, well.
I'll make a motion to approve the nomination of Craig Stevens as the teaching position at Newmarket Junior Senior High School.
I'll second that.
Right, yeah, and hand those back. Obviously, we developed new applications. This was done before that.
We don't put that on there.
We don't
do that. Date of birth.
I saw that, and I said, ugh.
Yeah.
So there's a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Okay, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
We have all the manifests.
Yeah.
There are six manifests. It's faster now. You've already signed most of them, Jim.
I did. Yeah.
I will make a motion to approve the total of all manifests in the amount of $387,635.02.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Calendar. Mules Fever Week, followed by winter vacation. Tuesday, March 8th is voting from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. the basement of Town Hall.
I wanted to.
And the school warrant.
Just wanted to ask about that. I noticed on the website that they published that the absentee ballots were ready for that. So while we're on TV, if you know anyone that's out of town, make sure they get their ballots because those votes also do count.
And do so by contacting the SAU office?
Yeah. There was a date on there. Of course, I didn't pay attention to it. But, you know, there's a window mm-hmm. that you can submit your request. And
659-5020. Penny will be happy to help you. Anything else of note?
I think the girls basketball tournament starts on Tuesday, the 22nd. And then I think the boys starts the following Tuesday, March 1st. So keep your eyes peeled for that. And buy your t-shirts that Project Graduation is going to be selling to wear to the games.
Okay. Then we do have need to go into non-public session this evening. So I'd ask for a motion to do so. There are RSA 91-A:3, Roman numeral two, paragraphs A and D. So A is with regard to a personnel matter, and D is with regard to contractual matter potentially regarding sale or lease of real estate.
So moved.
I'll second that.
When you're ready, Jim, if you wouldn't mind calling the roll.
I will, yeah. Cliff Chase.
Aye.
Linda Montagani.
Aye.
Kelly Foster.
Aye.
Chet Jablonski. Aye. Meg Looney Moore.
Aye.
Non-public.